Welcome to VSU Voice. I'm James Tremere, and today we'll be talking about the internet, its uses, its fears, and how it applies to students' daily life. Joining us today, Michael Taylor. He is a professor here at Valdosta State University. He works in the telecommunications department in radio and television. Also with us, Dave Tyler. He is a graduating senior here at VSU, and we'll be talking with him a little bit about how he uses the internet in his graduation. also with us is Ronny Smith. Ronny is also a graduating senior, and he hopes to use multimedia in his career moves, the internet and multimedia. Playol Shippey, a junior here at VSU, also an expert on the internet. And we'll be right back after these messages.
It's real simple to use.
My biggest concern right now with the internet is that lack of privacy.
I know I'm not here expecting, but I am Michael Jordan, chairman of the board of the College Fund. By keeping tuition costs down, bright, deserving kids get a shot at going to college. Because let's face it, no matter how gifted you are,
we all could use a little help. Please support the College Fund. Mine is a terrible thing to waste.
Want to go one-on-one?
Where's Michael?
National Guard duty.
Ah, bet he's just sandbagging.
I don't think so.
Sure he is. He left us with all the big fires to put out.
Over 52% of our military is made up of the National Guard and Reserve. They serve in times of war and in times of disaster. And the jobs they perform are hard enough without you making it harder.
Well, let's hope he's ready for some late nights when he gets back.
Please support your employees in the National Guard and Reserve.
They've given our generation a label. X. Generation Nothing. They say we have no sense of purpose. They say we have no war to fight and no cause to believe in. Who are they? Join the thousands of us who are making a difference and wear a label that does mean something.
Where's dinner?
Well, I thought you'd be home a couple of hours ago, and everything away.
What is this? Pizza?
You had just called me. I would have known what...
Dinner ready is pizza.
Honey, please don't be so loud. Please don't... Let go of me!
Get in the kitchen!
No!
Do you want to see what hurts? That's what hurts! That's what hurts!
Oh, please! Please!
For information, call 1-800-END-ABUSE.
Hello and welcome back to VSU Voice. I'm James Tremere. Today we're talking about the internet. Playol, when we discuss the internet and its uses as a student, what exactly is the basis of this? Like a search engine, if I were going in, what is a search engine?
Search engine or I guess programs or devices that you can use, you know, you simply type in a keyword and then it will bring up a listing of sites and you know, that you can click on then and go into that are related to that topic. Of course, you know, to actually get what you want out of the search takes a bit of practice and playing around and tinkering to figure out, you know, which words are going to work the best, and that way you can find what you're actually looking for.
Ronny, when you use these search engines, do you find there's one in particular that is the easiest to use, or how do you decide?
That begin for their first time on the internet, I would probably go ahead and suggest to you to use Yahoo. It's very simple. They have categories that are broken down succinctly based on what you're looking for, and you simply move the little mouse pointer icon to the various area that you want to explore, click it on, and it will take you directly into that. Or if you wish to particularly go ahead and search for something in particular, you can query under that keyword, and it's real simple to use. And it's also, they're breaking it up to where they have, instead of just Yahoo for the whole US, you can go Yahoo for Atlanta or the other major market cities, which also makes it very useful as well.
There's a large amount of fear that is brought about when you mention internet. Dave, do you find it a fearful place to go, or do you use it frequently and enjoy it?
Well, I use it frequently for information purposes, mail, like electronic mail wise. Basically, in that genre, electronic mail, I don't use it because of the fear of those people out there who could get a hold of it.
Yeah.
And I'm not exactly quite clear on the methods of that, and if people can get my mail if I send it over the internet.
Yeah.
And that's my biggest fear.
That is pretty scary. Michael, do you share his fears, or do you?
Well, to some degree, but not necessarily so much a fear, but using email especially from the standpoint of figuring, if I send a postcard, obviously I'm not going to write anything in a postcard that I don't want all of you reading. And email is much the same way. Unfortunately, most of us go into it with the idea that our email has that same level of protection that a sealed letter would have. Would be nice, but not so. And so from that standpoint, you just need to be careful what you're mailing, who you're contacting, and why. Other than that, the actual use of the internet, I think one of my concerns is the lack of, if you will, the lack of safe encryption, the safe privacy problems of, I won't engage in any commerce on the internet. There is just no way that I'm going to let somebody have my social security number coupled to one of my credit cards, because I have no way of knowing for sure who these people are. I mean, with catalogs or other types of ordering, I've got a fairly safe feeling about the people I'm ordering from over the phone. With the internet, I mean, it could be some 13-year-old kid in Southern California, and the next thing I know, my identity is out there under 17 other people. So from that standpoint, that's, I think, my biggest concern right now with the internet, is that lack of privacy and safe transmission of information.
Ronny, do you think that as far as it progresses, do you think we'll eventually have a way of sending email in a safe form, or do you think it's always going to be something that we could consider a postcard?
Well, the current problem with sending electronic mail is that you have to have some type of encryption process, which basically takes the letter to text and converts that into a format so that if I, as a hacker out there, will not be able to break into it and understand that and decipher your code. So that's the problem in it, is being able to develop a good enough code to use so that somebody can't figure it out. But there again, therein lies the problem. If somebody can develop something to encrypt it, well, there's someone out there that can also, you know, figure it out and unravel it. But eventually, I do believe that it will become more safe. But as Mr. Taylor suggested, there's no way I would do any actual transactions of Social Security number or Visa, MasterCard, that sort of thing out there right now. It's too early as yet. But hopefully, as the technology progresses, it will eventually pick up.
Playol, do you agree with what he just said about the encryption, or do you feel that it's going to form into something more with the way technology progresses?
Well, like he said, there's always going to be someone out there who has the ability to get a hold of the information. But if you look at it as far as written letters, there's a chance someone might get a hold of one of them too. I mean, honestly, the only way you can make sure that no one gets it is if you tell someone or hand them the letter personally. You know, I mean, there's always going to be a danger of someone getting a hold of it, and the odds of it actually being you that someone does get a hold of the number is, you know, just way against it. You know, it's just so much information out there And if you know, if you happen to be the one that gets robbed or you know cheated over this, then you know you're one in a million, pretty much.
Right. How do you use the internet daily?
Well, for you know, pretty well-rounded. I use it a lot for you know education and research. You know, for class projects and papers and things like that. It's a lot easier than going down the library and searching through books. You know, and you know, just simply call up the information that you need. And of course, entertainment-wise, use it for games.
That is so. Entertainment is probably the most fun aspect of the internet. And we'll talk more about the entertainment aspect when we come back.
You're never really sure if it's a 9-year-old in La Jolla.
You can start a business, learn to play a musical instrument.
In America, you are not required to offer food to the hungry or shelter to the homeless. There is no ordinance forcing you to visit the lonely. In fact, nowhere in the Constitution does it say you have to provide anything for anybody. Thank you for all you've given. Imagine what more could do.
One of the reasons lions roar is to warn threatening bachelor males from other prides to stay away from their young. Here, a lion cub gets a lesson in proper roaring from its father. Teaching this behavior is not just crucial to the pride, but also to the survival of the species. Just a reminder how important it is for fathers to spend time with their children.
You are 100% unadulterated energy. You have no choice but movement. You aren't acted on. You are action. You have the power to make the world a better place. You already know how to do it. Volunteer now for the American Red Cross. Call your local chapter for details.
20 kids. For 1 hour a week, you leave your concrete world of flip phones and faxes and talk to 20 kids about how business works. They will question everything, but those 20 kids will talk to 20 more. So by Saturday, which is set on Thursday, could be halfway around their world. You get to make a difference. Could just make the rest of your week pretty dull. That's the new JA, teaching kids how business works.
We're back with VSU Voice. I'm James Tremere. And we were talking with Playol about the entertainment aspect of the internet. What types of thing could I look for if I were to go to a website right now? What type of
Well, there's of course the chat lines, which you know many people use, simply carry on conversations, you know, with other people from around. But then there's the, I guess, the more advanced forms of the same thing. There are several actual games that you can go and purchase and play against other people over the internet or with other people over the internet. There's a new one actually coming out this month called Ultima Online, in which they've actually created an entire virtual world on the internet, and you create your character, you go in, and several different things are there. You can start a business, learn to play a musical instrument, join in with another group of people and build a castle. It's kind of a fantasy-based game, but sounds pretty good, and I'm kind of excited about it.
Wow. What you mentioned chat lines. Could you explain just a little bit more about?
Well, chat lines, you simply, you can find them several different ways. You can join like a particular type of chat line in which, you know, there's like, there's, I'm trying to think of the best way to explain this. There's sites that you can join that you have to be a member, you have to pay a fee to access, or there are a lot of free chat lines out there also. Now, chat lines are basically, it's a site in which you go on and you log on with a name and you're able to talk to other people. You know, you type in your message and it all kind of rolls up on the screen what everyone said. You can talk to each other, or you can send a private message or meet in a private room to speak with people and things like that.
Michael, on the opposite end, as far as a learning tool for teaching, gathering information, What do you use the internet for?
A combination of things, because obviously I tend to direct my students for doing their research toward the internet with some caution, because obviously anyone can be posting to a particular website. So when you don't have a signed article or a signed piece of research or information, you're never really sure if it's a 9-year-old in La Jolla or someone who's a PhD researcher at one of the New York universities. I mean, it's just that simple. But at the same time, there's a wealth of material on the internet. If you imagine the internet basically using the search engine as a huge card catalog, well, I don't know, I mean, you guys may not have actually had to deal with a library where you went in and searched through the card catalog to find all of these topics.
I remember those.
Basically, the search engines are, in a sense, a giant card catalog. You start looking, clicking, learning, as Playol mentioned, trying different search words to come up with the information you're looking for. And at that point, it's like opening up a huge vault of research information far beyond what could be housed in any single library, because now you're worldwide. You're able to pull in material and information from Japan, Australia, Germany, the US, as well as Uganda, all in the same search. So it gives much more information, much more ability to use information and access it. The printout becomes a lot easier, although they are obviously looking for ways to find a way to charge us for all of that information that we're currently getting free. But at the moment, it's like having a combination of every encyclopedia ever printed, coupled to almost every magazine and journal ever published, so that you get a wealth of information by doing that. I've used it for academic research, casual research, for students that are getting ready to graduate. One of the quickest ways to find out, okay, I'm weighing three different job offers. One of the great sites that's out there is the one that will allow you to compare cost of living in Valdosta, Georgia, San Francisco, California, Des Moines, Iowa, and Dallas, Texas. And if you've got offers in each of those cities, you find out that, well, gee, they're not offering me as much in Dallas, but for what they're going to pay me in Dallas, I could rent, well, maybe a closet in San Francisco, and you get a chance to actually do a concrete measure of what to expect based on some place that you know and be able to search that way. Census data all over the place, all kinds of things that make it a lot easier to deal with life.
Huh. Ronnie, As a new, I guess you'd call it a newbie, to the internet world, though I've learned a lot as I've gone along these last few months, when I first started using the internet, I was plagued with using a search engine and getting lots and lots and lots of things, an overwhelming amount of information. Do you have any advice, maybe?
The search engines, when you query a search, you're getting anything in that database that matches what you typed in for. Whether or not it's relevant to what you're searching for is really up to anyone's guess. You can spend literally hours going through all of the matches. Generally, what it does is it hits the ones that have the best percentage relating to exactly what you want, versus, say, if I'm looking for TV and jobs production. If I typed in all of that, it's going to automatically try and match up TV jobs production. And then it's going to start breaking it down by TV, then just jobs, and then just productions. Well, automatically, go ahead and pick the top layered tier of the ones that you find first. Mm-hmm. Because when you start rolling through the other ones, it's pretty much just overkill.
Dave, what is your favorite website? What is your favorite place to visit on the web?
Actually, I don't really have a particular favorite one, but right now, since I'm getting ready to graduate, the TVjobs.com is one of my frequent ones.
Oh, right. And we'll talk more about the internet after this.
Want to deny somebody that right to know how to build a pipe bomb, but...
We want to see our children succeed. But setting easy goals for our kids creates the toughest obstacle they'll ever face. Because succeeding in the real world isn't easy. Help the effort to raise standards in America's public schools. Call 1-800-96-PROMISE.
You don't need algebra, geometry, and calculus to get this job. Now, if that doesn't convince you to take math courses, I don't know what will. Call NACME. We'll tell you what you need to do.
It's only a little motor oil.
What difference is one drop of paint going to make?
This much fertilizer isn't going to pollute anything.
You're looking at a sea of excuses. Created drop by people like you and me. Our waters can be saved if each of us does their part. Drop by drop. If we all do a little, we can do a lot.
Brought to you by the Natural Resources Defense Council, the EPA, and the Ad Councils of the U.S. and Japan.
Adam has a disease that's making him tired, stunting his growth, and breaking down his immune system. A disease affecting over 12 million children. A disease that's totally curable. It's called hunger. Second Harvest is America's food bank network. Just call your local food bank to help.
Welcome back to VSU Voice. We're discussing the internet. Ronny, during the break, you were mentioning fees to download. Could you explain a little bit about what you were talking about?
Okay, basically what's happening is that companies are now working on methods to be able to possibly charge you for some of the information that you get for free right now. Versus, let's say, if I'm doing a research project on trees of South Georgia, and I need studies relating to the botany and so forth like that, dealing with the biology. Well, if I need detailed scientific reports, and if this company has them, and I go to them through the internet, they may want to charge me for that than versus just posting it on there for free. So the thing is that you may not have to download the whole thing. You can just pay by the sheet or whatever. But right now, most everything we get is free, but it looks like that the big corporations out there, they want to push it to where they can start to capitalize and make money, because it does cost money to operate the internet per se for these companies. So, you know, if you want it, you got to pay for it.
Well, in tying into that, Ronny, one of the things that's one of the advantages as students that you still maintain is by being able to roll into databases through a university library. The university frequently has already paid the fees, the subscription charges for a lot of the database services that are commercial. And by doing that, all students that access on campus have the ability to get it for free. Once you roll out into the world and start earning a living, the companies figure, okay, you can pay us now. So from that standpoint, it's still one of those things of there are certain types of access. Later on, public libraries frequently will go ahead and pay the fees and the charges, and then you can dial in to a library through the internet, be able to do the work without having to head down to the library to actually get on one of their machines.
Another thing that has I've heard a lot about in the last few months is prohibiting certain types of websites. Mm-hmm. What is your feeling, Ronny, about?
Well, as basically for my own opinion, I really don't favor government censorship. Okay, America's not a pretty place, albeit there's a lot of bad things that happen, but we don't really need the government to step in and tell you what you can or cannot see. If parents have problems or issues with that, I'm sure the technology will soon be available to buy devices to block access to these particular sites and so forth. You can do it, block 900 numbers for kids at home that call on the telephone, that sort of thing. It's just another application of the technology, but we should not go out and punish the entire society to say, you cannot view or watch or hear because we deem it, you know, to be. I don't agree with that at all.
I think that some of it should fall on the servers themselves. The internet servers should have more of a say. I know there's a lot of talk about making the servers provide every site there is on their server. But the problem with that is you have a Jiffy Mart. Not all Jiffy Marts sell pornographic magazines. So why should the servers have to offer that if they don't want to, if they choose to? Then you come down to the parents. They can choose a server that doesn't allow access to that and does not own their server. Of course, mm-hmm. servers have a bit of a problem with trying to find all these sites and blocking them out, which maybe these sites could cooperate with these particular servers and, you know, send out a letter saying, well, our site's here, you know, you could block it out for yourself if they'd be willing to cooperate, but you have to have that. But that way you don't get into the censorship. And though I may personally disagree with a lot of these sites, I don't want to get into censorship, because you censor one thing, you have to censor other things and end up getting into the purpose of the internet being an open exchange, I guess, of ideas would be gone then.
Michael, as mm-hmm. a member of the next generation, mm-hmm. or the previous generation.
Prior generation.
Prior generation. How do you feel about the censorship?
Well, I've always been a very strong free market advocate, to the point that my concern is I don't like what I hear from white supremacists. But if I deny them a voice, if I deny them the right to say what they say under the First Amendment, pretty soon we just kind of start bringing all of the edges in to the point where suddenly the middle is the edge and nobody has a right to speak. I agree with what Playol was saying, that we need to look at the idea that servers are, in effect, a service provider. It's the equivalent of a publishing house. Mm-hmm. Nobody's telling Doubleday that it is censorship if they refuse to publish an author's book. That's their right. That's their purpose. Mm-hmm. That's why they're there. I think servers need to begin to take a little more active role in what their site will offer access to. CompuServe has recently come up with, I believe it's called Wham, that is a kid-friendly, family-friendly site that allows the parents to know that, okay, when the kids are here, they're safe, we don't have to worry about it. By the same token, if there's someone out there that wants to access something different, I think they need to have the right to.
David, do you feel the same way about the censorship?
I basically feel the same way. I may not agree with all the sites that are out there, like how to build pipe bombs sites. I don't agree with it, but the information's there. I mean, I certainly wouldn't want to deny somebody that right to know how to build a pipe bomb, but I don't personally agree with it.
Just keep it out of my backyard.
Keep it out of my house and backyard, or car.
Playol, before we leave, if I wanted to, outside of the school here, if I wanted to get online, what would I need to do?
Well, you can always check your Yellow Pages for internet service providers, or there's a lot of local providers, which I personally favor local providers over the larger ones like, you know, Prodigy or AOL, but you get a lot of more personal attention then, you know, that way. There are several here in town, actually, and you just simply check the Yellow Pages and you can get in touch with any of them.
This whole AOL thing, I heard about it a while back. Are they still having the same problems as
they were? Well, the problem stemmed from people basically wanting to go ahead and sue because they were dialing up and they would dial for months at a time before they finally were able to get in. And they're still, you know, getting charged. And they have basically went ahead and filed a class action lawsuit. And that prompted AOL to change part of its policy and so forth.
Well, hopefully that whole mess is going to be cleaned up and out of everybody's way. Thank you very much for watching. I hope to see you next week here on VSU Voice.